Now, to the world about us presents a rare interview with a reluctant hero, the world's
most accomplished astronaut,
John Young. It's illustrated by film which has not been shown before.
This is the story of John Young, five times in space, twice to the moon, and commander of the world's first space shuttle.
Set sequencer start, T-minus 20 seconds and counting, T-minus 15, 14, 13, T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, we've gone for main engine start, we have main engine start.
In April 1981, Chief Astronaut John Young flew the world's first spaceship into orbit and brought it back to Earth again. An almost anonymous hero, an obsessively private man, had become the greatest space explorer of them all. The boy who would one day drive a go-kart on the moon grew up in a small town in Florida. And though his high school magazine noted his fine academic record, it was suspicious of his poise. You seem, it said, a bit modest. But there was nothing modest about his will to succeed as scholar and athlete. He excelled at football, and his teammates, who called him Brains, predicted he'd go far. But no one dreamed he'd end up here in the astronaut's inner sanctum, though even in the 40s there were dreams of space.
Sure, we did a lot of work with space and read a lot of books about space. Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon and Edgar Rice Burroughs' books on probably the first science fiction, you know, John Carter on Mars and that bunch. We did a lot of that. We had a lot of models that we worked on, little tiny models, but to say that you'd ever be an astronaut was just not practical because there wasn't any such thing.
But there were test pilots, and Young was determined to become one. He joined the U.S. Navy in 1952, armed with an honors degree in science. Ten years later, he was flying prototype Phantoms in tests that pushed machines and men to their limit. The risks were high, but so was the glory. And Young himself set two world records, although now, he says, it was just a job.
You like to do jobs that allow you to get hands-on experience with making new vehicles work. Yeah, I think that advance in technology is very important to the world today, really is.
That's what drives you?
Pretty much these days, yeah.
But 20 years ago, it was different. NASA had just announced that a second batch of 9 test pilots had been enlisted in America's great space adventure. They would be called the Gemini astronauts. On the far right, avoiding the center, as always, was John Young. The diffident southerner had become one of the super elite, but he would find that the long, unglamorous grind of aeronautical SWAT was only beginning. He underwent exhaustive medical tests because the physical demands of space were still largely unknown. For 16 hours a day, month after month, his body was toughened and his reflexes sharpened in what must have seemed an endless program of survival training on land, sea, and in the air.
This is parasail in the GEMINI program that we practiced because we use ejection seats. And so the theory was that you had to know how to land in water with a pressure suit on. It was good training. It was a lot of fun, parasailing. You know, it's the kind of thing people do now at the resorts all over the place. But back in those days, that was in the early 60s, it was something new.
As Young remembers it, it was all so easy. But then he was the most laid-back astronaut on the team. His Gemini colleagues called him the uncomplaining dark horse, the guy who made the hard work seem effortless. And yet the pressure was relentless, the discomfort constant. When he wasn't draining a waterlogged spacesuit, he was being locked inside a centrifuge to test his response to G-forces.
And they'd shake you at about, as I recall, 11 cycles per second. And we found out that anything in excess of about a quarter of a G, the instrument panel was so blurred that you couldn't read it. They would run at the Gemini launch vehicle profile, which is about, I don't know, it went all the way up to 7 Gs. Well, it just feels like your hand's 7 times heavier than it would be normally. But the part that they were interested in, they only went to like 4.5 Gs. That's nothing. There's a special technique involved in getting out so you didn't get water in the spacecraft. And we went to survival training all over the world. Panama, we trained for desert survival training at Reno, Nevada, and trained for water survival training in Pensacola with the Navy.
In March 1965, John Young became the first of the Gemini astronauts to go into space, with Mercury veteran Gus Grissom, who 2 years later would die a fiery death on the launching pad. Now Gemini 3 was nearly ready for liftoff. For John Young, who was earning a reputation as the least emotional man on Earth, it must have been an overwhelming moment.
Felt very good. We'd worked very hard to get started in the Gemini program, and it was a real honor to be picked to go on a first flight. There again, anybody could have done the job. In fact, they had picked two other fellows to go earlier, and it was they had to cancel them out because of one reason or another. So it was not only did I feel very good, I felt lucky as a dickens.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ultra liftoff. Clock started. We're a little bit high on the flight plan, but no problem. Holograms.
Okay, holograms, go for
staging. Roger, looks good.
America's first two-man flight would circle the Earth 3 times, and Young and Grissom, with the aid of an onboard computer, would alter their own orbital path. The U.S. was overhauling Russia in the space race. John Young's photographs from outer space gave man a breathtaking new perspective of his planet. Young and Grissom, the returning heroes, took their bow in New York, honored with a traditional ticker tape parade. Then it was a whistle-stop tour across the nation for the two astronauts, who were suddenly out of their depth, especially Young. Nothing in his life had prepared him for this. A deep introvert from the deep south had become a superstar overnight. And a political chess piece as well. Another conquest in space was good news for the White House. So now, a country boy who hated the spotlight walked with presidents and in the chariot of kings, prepared to wave like royalty. For John Young, king for a day, it was mercifully soon over. Now he was back in the working groove, the long slog of training and testing. A man who'd been in space was being used as an engineer's probe to locate the fault in one of the early Apollo systems.
We had to go back and redesign it. That's a typical kind of engineering thing that astronauts do, which sounds very glamorous, but they really spend a heck of a lot of time doing dog work of that nature.
Astronauts like Young, presented to the public as church-going nice guys, were in fact made of much raunchier stuff. They'd got where they were by risking their necks, and they still did, unofficially. They were given T-38 fighters for their personal use, million-dollar runabouts, in which they'd commute from Houston, Texas, to Lake Edwards in California, a flight beyond the aircraft's normal range. It was a matter of honor among astronauts to fly in on an empty fuel tank, a test of nerve that John Young was said to have invented, although he denies it now. But by July of 1966, Young, as commander of Gemini 10, had more pressing concerns. An Agena rocket was to be fired into space and parked in orbit. The astronauts would follow and attempt a rendezvous. It was one of the trickiest maneuvers ever attempted. Young's wife didn't want him to go, but he told her, "It's my job."
She packed my bags last night, pre-flight. 0 hour, 9 a.m. And I'm gonna be high as a kite by then. I miss the earth so much, I miss my wife. It's lonely out in space on such a timeless flight.
Rendezvous with that Agena, which was passive. We did it by eyeball, the kind of old techniques that you would use in pre-World War I days. It was a lot of fun to do that. I think the thing that the Gemini 10 mission achieved that was most significant from a technical standpoint was the use of that docked Agena to extend the range of orbits that you could fly. That the fact that I was able to fly on the Agena and Mike Collins was able to crawl over and bring a package back that had been up on that Agena for 3 months while it was up in space. In other words, visit another passive satellite from space and bring something back. I think that was really a significant milestone. We also made a landing that was about as close to, as you can get to the ship without being on the flight deck, and that was pretty good. So we had a lot of, we had a really interesting mission from start to finish. And in fact, the old Gemini allowed us to demonstrate a real routine operations in near-Earth space. In its day, it did things that even now the Russians are claiming our routine. Say it was really something.
But it was nothing compared with what lay ahead. In May 1969, Young, with fellow astronauts Stafford and Cernan, walked in the footsteps of the crew who'd perished in the Apollo fire 2 years earlier. The Saturn rocket, with its 7.5 million pound thrust, stood poised for the momentous Apollo 10 mission, preparing the way for the first man on the moon.
10, 9, we have ignition sequence start. Engines on, 5, 4, 3, 2, all engines running. Launch commit. Liftoff. We have liftoff 49 minutes past the hour.
First 2 or 3 hours, the Earth shrinks to about as small as it gets, as you can tell any difference. And from then on, when you're looking back at it, it looks like a picture. There's really not enough dimensions to see anything but something that's flat. It was very strange. It looked almost like something out of science fiction. You didn't know whether to believe it or not. But I can tell you that we did it. We didn't use mirrors. It was something.
We see it on our monitor, too.
Roger.
People will just love being in weightlessness. It is just delightful. It's like swimming underwater with nothing to push against, and it's just a wonderful feeling. Once we get enough people up there who've experienced it, it will probably be difficult to get them back, really.
You might notice the dynamics here. I just do whatever he says.
Hey, Tom, the flight surgeon here wants you to be sure to log all your exercise.
I got you. That's perfect zero gravity there. Boy, I tell you, it's nothing like it.
Ken, this is Houston. Is there, Roger, is there any sort of air currents there affecting it that you can feel?
3 men in a claustrophobic chamber a quarter of a million miles from Earth, living cheek by jowl in a weightless world, day and night. But it was a small price to pay for what they were about to see. This was it, the dress rehearsal for a moon landing. Stafford and Cernan undocked from the command module and descended to within 9 miles of the lunar surface, leaving John Young alone in the module, orbiting the moon.
It's very different from what you see looking through a telescope, traveling over the lunar surface at about a mile a second, looking down. everything is different. The rills are like rivers. There are certain craters at many places on the moon that are bright, speckly rayed craters that stand out just like stoplights, so that you can go around the moon and recognize, once you get to know it, just where you're at on the surface. In fact, much easier than you can recognize where you are on the Earth, unless you're a real student of geography.
Young watched the Earth rise, knowing that he'd been tantalizingly close to the moon, and yet he hadn't landed. He must surely have felt frustrated.
There was some discussion at the time that they wanted to land Apollo 10 on the moon, but the feeling was that we just didn't know enough to do that. So we took the next thing, and I was happy to be on the next mission that I could get on. And I think everybody else in the office was the same way. I don't know. Just never would have occurred to me to want it to have been anyplace else than where I was on Apollo 10.
Back on Earth, just 2 months later, in July of 69, Houston, home of Mission Control and home of astronauts, had become the space capital of the world. Neil Armstrong, on Apollo 11, the very next mission, had walked on the moon. The Americans had won the space race. In the astronaut's office, John Young was given command of Apollo 16, but he had 3 years to wait.
Sequence is starting.
We have ignition sequence start.
5, 4,
the engine's now
3,
building up to 7.7 million pounds.
All engines running. Launch commit.
We have a liftoff.
We have a launch commit,
and we have a liftoff. The swing
okay,
arm
babe.
Moving back. We cleared the tower.
Roger, clear the tower.
Houston is now controlling.
Bro, you have good thrust in all five.
Roger. Pitch and roll program started.
Roger.
16 now maneuvering to its proper flight path attitude. Mark 27 seconds.
The 1972 Apollo 16 mission was dogged by technical problems from the start, and right up to the last moment, there was a real possibility that the landing itself would have to be abandoned. But finally, in the lunar module with Charles Duke, John Young headed for the Descartes Plateau and the greatest moment of his life. A landing on the moon. And this time, the coolest man in space couldn't suppress his excitement.
Here you go for landing.
42 LPD. Okay, fuel is good, 10%. That comes a shadow. Okay, down at 3, 50 feet, down at 4. Give me one quick up. You're backing up slightly. Okay, 2 down, stand by for contact. I'm gonna let her down, you level off. Better on down. Okay, 76%, plenty fat. Contact. Boom. Wow! Come on, man! Look at that! Engine arm. He said command override. Okay.
Recalling that moment 10 years later, Young is almost unbelievably downbeat.
Well, if you know NASA, you knew that as soon as we stepped on the lunar surface, we were about 20 minutes behind in our timeline, and I thought, I don't know how we're going to catch up. But on the first exploration out there, we managed to catch up and set up a very complex science station and do a lot of work on the surface.
Come on out here and give me a salute. Big Navy salute. Off the ground, I'm sure. There we go. It's really some crater.
As you come around there, there's a rock in the near field on this rim that has some white on the top of it. We'd like you to pick it up as a grab sample.
This one right here?
That's it.
This one right here?
That's it. You got it right there.
The area at Descartes was really beautiful. There were a couple of craters, North Ray Crater and South Ray Crater, that had beautiful rays that had thrown themselves right across the surface. And it was just something. The browns and the hues of the surface were, and the extreme whites were just something to behold when you're standing there looking at it. None of the camera pictures that we took even begin to grab any of the contrast that you could see with the eye.
Look at the size of that biggie. It is a biggie, isn't it? It may be further away than we think.
No, it's not very far. It was just right beyond you.
And we better press on for the big boulder.
You couldn't tell how far away something was until you looked back at the lunar module, because you had no perspective. It's very easy to see from the topography where you were going, but to estimate sizes of things, was just unbelievable.
Well, Tony, that's your house rock right there.
Very good.
Don't get too near the edge of that thing.
The rover itself weighed over 1,200 pounds with a crew in there, but on the moon that's only 200 pounds. So the maximum speed of the rover was about 10 kilometers an hour. But if you got going 10 kilometers an hour and you cut the wheels, you'd slide along sideways or you'd slide backwards. The thing that really saved us was that there was nobody coming from the other direction about 55 miles an hour. You knew when you were up there, you're all by yourself. And it was exciting.
Then I'll tell you, Andy's never seen a driver like this. Okay, when he hits the craters and starts bouncing, it's when he gets his rooster tail. He makes sharp turns.
Why, Houston, the beauty of this place is...
What about walking on the moon? Was that difficult?
I think one of these days space stations will have some gravity field like that, because that's very pleasant. It's enough so that you can do literally amazing feats. We could stand at the foot of the lunar module with our pressure suit on, which weighed 370 pounds, pick up a 100-pound sack of lunar rocks in one hand, and jump flat-footed up to the second rung of the lunar module, which was about 6 feet off the ground. When you practice this in one gravity on the Earth with your pressure suit on and all that 370 pounds of weight, you could barely lift your big toe. It's really nice to be up there.
When you look up these days at a Texas moon, do you sometimes find it hard to believe you've been out there?
Yeah, sure. It's difficult to believe. I'm just sorry that we don't have a permanent inhabited base up there right now operating, because from a geological and geophysical standpoint, I think the moon is one of the coming high frontiers in the next 10 or 15 years. I expect we will.
About 10 minutes ahead and we're ready to move out.
We'll get it up there. See how nice and leisurely it's been? That's the way it should be, getting ready for our ascent.
10 seconds.
What a ride, what a ride.
Roger, go at one. Roger, looking good here.
Every second had been recorded by TV cameras, but only an astronaut could know what John Young had really seen.
I think we've seen as much in 10 days as most people see in 10 lifetimes.
Did you discover God up there?
No, I don't think so.
No sense of awe, wonder?
No.
Why not?
Well, because I think that the way things are in space is the way they are, and I think that's a good thing. I think if people have to go into space to discover God, they've got some other kind of problem. Yeah.
You can find him back on Earth.
Or anywhere.
If the only miraculous thing in space was American technology, it was a miracle that was already running down. Even as Apollo 16 drifted towards splashdown, Washington was putting a dampener on the space program. For all the nation's applause, Young and his fellow astronauts would soon be grounded. Within 7 months, a depressing calm had settled over NASA. The Apollo program was over. The unused rockets were mounted like stuffed trophies in NASA's backyard. Yesterday's super technology was converted, overnight it seemed, into a museum. By the end of 1972, for a society addicted to novelty, the thrill had gone. Washington knew it and closed its coffers. There was the distant promise of something called the Shuttle, a prototype spaceship. But one by one, the astronauts were pulling out. Except for the man his colleagues still called the mysterious John Young. He'd stayed with the program, and they'd made him chief astronaut. Now, with space rookie Bob Crippen, he was in training for the maiden flight of the Shuttle, the rocket-driven plane that could be taken into orbit and brought back to Earth again, a spacecraft that would be reusable.
Of course, you can, not a whole lot you can say about UHF. And our electrical system, we don't get down into diodes and garbage like that. We do just talk to the overall schematic.
This time, Young wouldn't be just a passenger on a rocket. He'd be piloting a 100-ton machine, pioneering a cargo route into space.
You can recharge it on orbit, and you may have to jack up the cryo system to get that.
We're out of 18,500 feet, making a right turn into runway 22 at Edwards Air Force Base.
Each system is different, and if you like engineering, it's a lot of fun. It's mostly, if you don't like to fool with systems and you don't like grungy engineering jobs, I don't think people would care much being an astronaut, because that's what it's all about.
Altimeter's locked on. We're at 5,000. The gear coming on.
We did it for about 1,100 hours before the first space shuttle mission.
180 knots.
Look at all those switches in there. Now, Cripp's got to know what each and every one of those switches does when it's working right. And I've got to know about all those over on the left-hand side, and we've got to be able to work them in real time. And if they fail, we've got to know what to do. It may sound exciting to some people, but it's really pretty dull stuff. You're really busy, always doing some useful activity. And you know, space flight, at least in a test phase, is really an expensive proposition. So you try to fill up your working days with test objectives to perform. And the system inherently wants to do more than it's ever possible for you to do in a 24-hour day, much less a 16-hour day.
7,000 to go.
Roger. 50 knots. 30.
6,500 to go.
You got her.
Zero.
Okay. We do a reset.
Okay.
It was a relief for Young to get back in the air, although others have called this converted Boeing the Vomit Comet. When the plane went into a parabolic dive, Young had just 40 weightless seconds to escape from his spacesuit. He'd repeat the exercise 60 times.
Water connector locked.
Go.
Umbilical connector locked.
Young was turning back the clock nearly 20 years, going through the training grind of a rookie astronaut, a daunting assignment for a 50-year-old who now needed glasses.
You'll find we all get to wear those things sooner or later. Those were special glasses so that you could see better underwater.
John, you still read us, hard?
About 10, I can see them critters.
That little device right there you hold yourself on the spacecraft with, that's a prototype model of it. It's a manual latch that replaces automatic latches. If the automatic latch fails, you can pull that over, and by ratcheting that handle, you can cinch the door down tight.
What you want me to do now?
Just stand there.
Hop over there and get in it.
Well, it's pretty difficult to handle that, and sometimes our mock-up hardware, in spite of all our efforts, failed to work perfectly the first time. In fact, sometimes it didn't work the second time or the third time either. You're really looking at the task timeline with a pressure suit on, and can it be done? It's very difficult in a lot of cases to move a pressure suit and do the correct thing.
Okay.
You can take the subject to the bottom of the tank for final ballasting if everything looks all right. Take him slowly to the bottom of the tank for final ballasting.
They monitor you very carefully. There is a winch that's very much like a winch on a sailboat that you can close the payload bay doors manually and latch them.
Watch your head, John.
But it did work, and you can do that manually, and those techniques were developed by many of the astronauts and other people associated with STS-1. And it's a good technique. You really would have a lot of difficulty re-entering if the payload bay doors were open.
What makes an astronaut? What qualities does he need, above all?
The same thing that makes anybody else that's interested in their line of work. They have to be interested in it. They have to work hard at it. And they have to hang in there and do a good job at it. And I think that's true if you're making a television production or flying an airplane or going fishing.
Then how did you get where you are?
It's called perseverance. If you're the oldest guy there, they let you run it.
In April 1981, the oldest guy there took an $8 billion spaceship on its maiden flight and once again made history. Reliving it, he makes it sound like a Sunday afternoon drive.
There's Crip waiting to go fly. He doesn't look very nervous, but you can see I have a nervous smile there. I think I was as nervous as Cripp was, but I'm just so old that my heart wouldn't go any faster. But anybody who's not apprehensive about climbing on top of a first-time flight of a liquid hydrogen-oxygen rocket ship really doesn't understand the problem. And I think both Cripp and I were fairly nervous.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7.
This is 6, a slow motion film of the light off of those liquid hydrogen oxygen engines. They're the lightest weight, highest thrust engines in the world today that we know about. And they're really what makes a space shuttle go. As you see, the nose pitches forward when the engines light off, the solid rocket motors blow, and the vehicle lifts off a good deal faster than this. This, again, is high speed, slow motion. The most impact we got on the whole vehicle occurred right there at liftoff, and it was way beyond design spec. There's an inner tank access arm right there, and we come very close to it, 7 feet away.
America's first space shuttle, and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
The roll program, we thought from all our tests, was going to be very jerky and oscillatory, but it wasn't. It's just smooth as glass. We sent our weather plane up to check for weather, and you can see the contrails he left up there. The solid rocket motors, as it goes downrange, it casts a bright white hue on the back of the tank and really heats it up pretty good. This is a separation of solid rocket motors. It's taken through a camera inside the orbiter. You can see when those booster separation motors fire that it casts a plume all over the vehicle. And those solid rocket motors go up to 250,000 feet and they float back in the water and you recover them and reuse them. And I'd often said that I'd never volunteer to fly a reused set of rocket motors, and I found out they're going to put the first reused set on the first space lab mission. This is separation of the tank. As you can see, the aerodynamic heating has charted black. Up by the nose, there's more aerodynamic heating turned to black up there. When we came back and talked to the engineers, we said, boy, it looks like that tank's been in a war. And they said, shoot, we knew all about that, but they didn't tell us. This is a picture of Cripp taking his pressure suit off. There are more than 12 connections associated with connecting and disconnecting the parachute, and we thought we might have some trouble in zero gravity. You see that helmet floating around up there. It was really delightful to work up there in zero gravity. This is the first thing when we opened the payload bay doors and we looked out and we saw the tiles missing. Cripp said he wasn't nervous, but I was nervous.
Okay.
These are checks that we had to perform through the computers to check out to make sure switches were all working properly. Each hand controller has three switches in there, and we use a checklist, and I use the glasses so I can read the checklist. And here you see Cripp going up the space shuttle ladder. Boy, if we could do this on Earth, we'd really have a lot of fun. And of course, he never used the ladder the whole time that we were up there.
And we're up on the timeline, and the vehicle has just been performing beautifully, much better than anyone ever.
We finally closed the payload bay doors to do reentry, and this shows that closing. We're very interested in the performance of those doors because the key to the whole space shuttle is really based around those doors operating properly every time to put payloads in and out, to get access to cooling the vehicle.
Chase will be on time.
Okay. The shuttle had shown its capability as a cargo carrier in space. Now Young had to do the unprecedented, fly a spacecraft back to Earth.
This is reentry. We're probably moving at Mach 18.6. This is 12 times faster than real time. But it's really beautiful, and you could feel the vehicle turning right up over the water. Really tremendous. There was the Mach 10 roll reversal. This is a roll back at Mach 4.8 over Bakersfield, California. The vehicle was behaving very solidly. It's a beautiful handling machine. We thought there'd be a lot of buffet associated with flying it, but there was no buffet once we got subsonic. Just a classy smooth from then on. It's just incredible when you look and see the vehicle and see all that machinery hanging out on the back that there wouldn't be buffet associated with that, but there just wasn't any.
From an orbital speed of 17,000 miles an hour, Young had to steer the world's largest glider down through the atmosphere to hit an isolated landing strip in the Californian desert. He'd get only one shot at it.
Pinky Nelson was taking pictures underneath the orbiter with a chase plane to assess tile damage. And they found out we'd gotten about 300 tile hits.
smooth speed break.
We're coming down at 20 degrees gamma, which is about six times steeper than the average airliner makes an approach. You're maintaining your airspeed out there at about 285 knots, equivalent airspeed.
They're coming. They're down. 50 feet. 40. 30. 20. 10. 5. 4. 3. 2. 1. Touchdown.
The landing was, I'd have to say it was one of my best landings because I made a whole bunch of landings in T-38s right after the flight. None of them were as good as that one. Deceleration and roll out of the orbiter. We have the speed brakes open on the rudder there. The lake bed was giving us a lot of friction and the brakes worked really well. And we got the vehicle stopped in pretty much record time. It's hard to believe that the vehicle weighs as much as it does. It weighed about 99 tons. And it's quite impressive to be there on that lake bed.
It's not just a bus service in space, though. It's opening up all kinds of technological possibilities.
It's opened up a new, whole new era in the use of space for practical value and for exploration value. And for, in the long run, I think, putting human beings up there permanently. Both in near-Earth space and out by the moon, which is really near-Earth space, once you get the vehicles that you need to operate out there routinely. And I think you'll find that people will like to operate out there. And in about 50 years from now, I predict there'll be a lot of people working in space, not only on the moon, but on the other planets that we can get to, and probably on some of the asteroids.
Down to Earth again, this least flamboyant of men allowed himself a small gesture of triumph, even of joy. Could it be that he was human after all? But later, true to character, he will run from any suggestion that he's a superstar.
You know, we're getting away from all this super stuff because if our machinery gets a little more simple, everybody's going to be using it.
So astronauts will no longer be superstars?
Hope not, yeah.
Didn't you like that?
Huh? I don't know that I've ever been a superstar. You wouldn't get anybody around here to say that.
He may not claim to be a superstar, but how many working Joes are courted by politicians?
You have to be prepared to be able to communicate. If you're going to help the space program, you have to be able to tell people what you did in a reasonable fashion to keep the interest going. The Space Act sort of requires it by law. They want us to get out and tell about the benefits of the program. It's just another area to worry about.
And now that he's been honored again by the White House, where does a middle-aged astronaut go next? Will it be the golden handshake? Or is it true that even now, he's planning just one more ride in space?
We're going to take the space lab up in 1983, and that should be a fascinating mission. The space lab itself has got a multidisciplinary group of experiments on it. Atmospheric physics, solar physics, astronomy, life sciences, Earth observations, particle accelerations in space. It's going to be a very interesting mission.
Your wife's reported to have said she doesn't want you to go up again.
That's right, yeah. She said that about Apollo, too.
But you'll go?
Sure, yeah.
John Young's hometown of Orlando, Florida, is the site of Disney World, a fantasy land for the pursuit of daydreams. It embodies an especially American belief in the dual reality of science fiction and science fact. Here, Americans can dream of worlds beyond their reach, fired by the knowledge that a local boy once reached for the moon and got there. His monument is all around them, a spur to everyone who takes an ordinary road. And if this excessively modest small-town hero should ever doubt his own achievements, well, how many men still living have a museum as their epitaph?
But looking back at your life as a whole, if someone had to write an epitaph, not yet, for John Young, what would it be, do you think? What would you like to see?
Good grief. How would I like to see any epitaph? I have no idea. I worry about a lot of things, but I haven't been worrying about that yet. You're really pushing me, aren't you? Shoot.
If it were to say, John Young, the ultimate explorer, how would you feel?
I'd feel sorry for the guy who wrote it. Shoot.
Airspeed 271 knots. Fido says it couldn't be any better.
Real good on the news.
Right on glide slope. Approaching center line. Looking great.
280 knots.
They're coming. They're down. Everything looks real good. 50 feet. 40. 30. 20. 10. 5. 4. 3. 2. 1. That's down. Those gears, 10 feet. 5, 4, 3, touchdown. Put the ball, skipper.